Hi, welcome to my free Java video course, Lesson 6. My name is Markus Biel. My goal is to teach you Java in the easiest possible way. For feedback, send an email to info@markus-biel.com or tweet to @markusbiel. So, in Lesson 6 of this Java course, I'm going to talk about the tools which I'm using. However, before doing that, let's first of all recap what we learned in Lesson 5. In Lesson 5, I talked about visibility modifiers. For example, this class here has public visibility modifier. We could actually change that. Now it's of package level or default level visibility, which means it's only visible from within the package that it was defined in. Now here we have the definition of our package, which ends in lesson 2, which means that from a class that is from a different package, and you see this is com Markus Biel Java course lesson 3, so that means that the class name will not see the class person anymore, and as such will not be able to use it. Actually, I've prepared that to try it out. You see it turned red and it says cannot be accessed from outside package. Let's change it to public again. And let's check. See, now it says unused, but still it's usable and it's not red anymore. Okay, so that much about the visibility modifiers. Second, I talked about non-visibility modifiers. Of course, not about all of them, but we talked about static. We used this static person counter because we needed it for our test. The idea was I created a number of objects calling that empty constructor. And then my idea was to call a method which returns dynamically the number of objects that I had created, which is 4 in this case. So this method, therefore, is also static. It returns the value of person counter, which is actually the primitive data type int. So primitive means it's not an object. So the exact comparison between primitives and objects I'll do at a later time. For now, just know it's something else. Anyway, so how was this incremented? We were in that empty default constructor and we used the increment operator by just calling, saying plus plus. What this actually means is, I mean, this is just a shortened form of person counter equals person counter plus 1. And what that means is take the current value, whatever it is at the moment, of person counter, add 1, the value of 1 to it, and then save the new value into the variable person counter again, which is up here. And as this variable is static, this was very important to make the code work. This means it's bound to the class and not to an instance, because we created 4 different instances. Would this variable not be static? That would mean that for every time this constructor is called, each of the objects would have their own value of person counter. So at the end, we would have 4 different objects with just person counter set to 1, because each of them would be incremented once. But because we wanted to increment them 4 times, we made it static. Yes, besides static, I also talked about local variables, which can be used within a method or within a constructor. Let's do it in here. I could have a string dfg, give it an empty string. I could have an int, call it my int, and assign it the value of 3. After the definition, I can use it, like assigning it a new value, 5. Before the definition, I cannot use it. See, this is red. It's not going to work. Also, I mean, this is a local variable, so actually the visibility is a bit less than private, which means it won't be visible or usable in a different method. See, this is red. So that's what we said about local variables. And I think this pretty much rounds it up of lesson 5. Now let's talk about the tools, as promised. So first of all, let's start with this computer. It's an Apple MacBook Pro. This IDE that I'm using here is IntelliJ IDEA, which actually at the moment is my favorite IDE. Before, I was using many years Eclipse. Eclipse is open source. It's also very popular at the moment, especially with companies, because it's open source and free. However, I think IntelliJ IDEA is really getting better and better every year, so I really like it and recommend it. And they're not paying me for saying that. But I mean, this is your personal preference, and every person is different, so I would say just try it out yourself. And there is also NetBeans. NetBeans is also very popular and is also for free. I'll just in a second, I'll show you where to get them. But let's have a closer look at my tests before. So in the tests, you might have seen it already. I'm using JUnit, which is a testing framework. Framework means it's like a tool set. It's a set of tools, set of classes, and it's open source, so it's free to use. And I mean, writing such a framework is not really hard work, but why doing it if it's already done? So this makes it really easy to start with testing. JUnit also is only one of a few testing frameworks. The second one I would tell you about is TestNG. I think they're pretty much the same, and really depends on the company that you work in. Some use JUnit, some use TestNG, or any other framework. I think between JUnit and TestNG, there are not so much big differences, so it doesn't really matter. I just decided to use JUnit in here. IntelliJ IDEA actually supports both of them out of the box, so you can easily try them. I'm not going in much more details, by the way. I mean, this is a Java tutorial, so I focus really on Java. Just to be complete, I wanted to mention what I'm using here, but I do this in lesson 6 because at the beginning, I think learning a new language is already quite difficult, so I wanted to focus on Java. But not that you're puzzled. What the heck is that here? What you're doing? I wanted to mention this is JUnit, and there is lots of documentation on the internet. So you can read a lot about it. Okay, so maybe we just go to the browser now and have a look. So first of all, I told you about IntelliJ IDEA, where it pops up. So you can download. I would first of all go with the free edition and then see if you like it or not. Besides, of course, there's Eclipse. This one is open source anyway. And then you can choose your operating system and 32 or 64 bit, whatever you need. Last but not least, NetBeans. Just press the download button, choose your language and operating system. And then also JUnit, let's have a look on that. In most IDEs these days, you won't have to install it because it would come pre-installed anyway. But just for the record, I mean, this also has lots of documentation. So yeah, here you can download the most current version. Let's check documentation. Here it also talks about Maven, which I'm, by the way, also using. So this way you can define in Maven that you want to use the current version 4.12 of JUnit, which I actually did because I'm also using Maven, which we're going to in a second. But after JUnit, let's also have a look on TestNG. TestNG on this page just provides the files for Eclipse, but as I told you in IntelliJ IDEA, it's included anyway. And I checked for NetBeans. I mean, I'm not so familiar with NetBeans, I have to admit. NetBeans, but I saw there is a plugin. Which you can download and install, so it probably works just as well. Now let's talk a bit about Maven. Maven is what's called a build management tool. So as the name implies, it manages your build. Now what's a build? Well, when you program your program, it consists of hundreds of classes, and then you would want to release them on production or send them to a client. And then of course you would not want to send each file separately. So you would usually do a package, a single file out of all the classes together. And in former times, let's say in prehistoric times, this was done manually, and this is really not a funny job. So people very soon started to program some little scripts to make this task easier. The first tool that I know of is probably Make. It's a Unix tool, and after Make, they came up with End. And Maven again is the successor of Maven, of End, sorry. And Maven currently exists in version 3. Besides Maven, there's also Gradle and other build tools. I'm using Maven. Here you see I defined that I'm using JUnit 4.12, and I also defined that my source encoding is UTF-8. Because what this build tool also can do for you, I mean, it can do so many things. Is environment specific settings, so that I tell that my source encoding is UTF-8, I can do it here, and so much more. So also about Maven, we can visit the website Maven. There you can download it. They also have a free book, which is really a great book. Here you can download all the files, even the sources that you would need. And also check Maven book. I really recommend that. As far as I remember, it's available as HTML. And also there should be a PDF somewhere. Well, this is just too long. Anyway, I know there is also a PDF available, which you can download. And so you can read all about Maven. Last but not least, let's also talk about a bit about text editors, because I think in at least one of the lessons I did so far, I told you you should start not with an IDE, but you should start with a text editor instead. Well, there are two that I would recommend. First of all, TextBed for Windows. I really like it using Windows. For Mac, it's unfortunately not available. In this, you can write your code, then you would save it, and then, assuming you have already downloaded the Java JDK, which I have also not talked about, because I assume this should be easy, but maybe we could first shortly go there. So for the JDK, so that you can download your code, you can just go here, say download. By the way, that was NetBeans, if you just saw it. And you can choose your operating system and download it. I assume you have already done that. And so when you have installed a text editor like TextPad or Sublime, here on Mac I'm using Sublime, which is also a great editor. Download button, it's also available for Windows and Linux. So using this text editor, here I've loaded the class person that we saw before. I mean, it helps you a bit. Like, see, I click on person name, it highlights the variable person name in all forms, but it would not so heavily assist you like you might have seen when I was in my IDE, which for the beginning is actually good, I think, because when your IDE is too smart, then you don't have to use your brain cells too much. I mean, after some time when you have coded too much, this is really welcome. But for the beginning, I really recommend to use your brain cells and so that you get used and familiar with all these keywords, public, class, private, static. You should really get familiar with that. And so for the beginning, just use a text editor. Then you can also go on the console and call Javac and compile the class. Also, this I won't show you because in this course, really, I only focus on the theory of Java. So, yes, I think that's it. A really short introduction of the tools that I'm using. If you have any questions, send me an email as always. Yeah. Thanks for watching. For feedback, send me an email to info@markus-biel.com or tweet to @markusbiel. I will try to incorporate your suggestions in one of the next lessons.